glad all our days. May the favor of the Lord our God rest on us. Establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands.
Yes.
Lord God, we come today, Lord, declaring that you are our God and we are your people. We come to worship you. We come to exalt you, to magnify your name in this place, oh God. You alone are worthy, God, of all of our praise. You are God. There is none beside you, oh Lord. We lift up our hands, our hearts, and our voices to you today. And we invite you, Lord God, to fill this place in your presence. Fill this place with your glory. Fill our hearts, oh God, as we come before you today. Give us what we need to take us on this journey a little while longer. We thank you, Lord God, that you are a faithful God. And our prayer is that we would be a faithful people. Then, Lord God, we would praise you all the days of our lives and tell the nations, oh God, that you are God. Hallelujah. You are almighty. There is none beside you, Lord. We ask you to have your way in us and through us today. In the name of Christ Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
Thank you.
We bless God that he has kept us to this time. And God has placed in us a praise, hallelujah, that when we open our mouths, the praises of the Lord come forth. We bless God. Turned it off. But we will continue to try to work that out. So don't worry about walking in front of the camera here. Okay?
Thank you. watches over Israel. He doesn't slumber, yes. Neither does he sleep.
Yes.
He watches over our going out,
yes,
and our coming in.
Yes.
Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we come to you in the wonderful name of your Son, Jesus Christ.
Yes.
We come, Lord, giving you all the praise and glory because you, O God, are King of kings and Lord of lords.
Yes.
You alone are worthy of our praise. You are unequal in power, unequal in majesty, unequal in glory. We praise you and we bless you this morning, God. Father, we come to you, giving you all thanks and praise for your goodness towards us. Father, you have kept us this week. We are here because of your grace and your mercy.
Yes.
Father, as we gather here, I pray that those gathered, Lord, for anyone who is in despair, that you, in your presence, Lord, they would find hope. For those who are anxious, Lord, that we would find peace in your presence. For any who are sick, Lord, may they surrender it up to you. For any cares that we have, Lord, may we cast them upon you. For the depressed, distressed, may they find hope in your presence this morning. We want to meet you here this morning, Lord, whatever our need is. Father, there are many concerns and things that trouble us. There's injustice, there's wars, there's natural disasters, there's all kinds of things going on, Lord. So we bring them to you, Lord. And we trust your word that says, godless men rant and rave. Kings and kingdoms threaten. But you, O God, are sovereign. And so we will lean on you and not in our own understanding. We will trust you, God, because you are faithful. You, our circumstances change, but you never change. And so, Lord, we will trust you. We will not lean on our own understanding. We will trust you, Lord. We will come to you for the wisdom that we need, for the courage that we need, for the humility that we need in the circumstances that we face in the days ahead. We ask you, Lord, to guide us, to guide our thinking, to guide our speaking, and to guide us in all of our ways. Father, I would want to also, as we, September kind of brings us into like a new year, a new beginning. As we think of the students returning to school, we want to ask, Lord, that you would bless the teachers, the parents, the children, and all who work in the education system, Lord, that our children would be protected, that they would be safe, that they would, all of their gifts and abilities would be respected and honored, their heritage be respected, that they would be just lifted up, Lord, and flourish and become all that you have in plan for them, Lord. We pray that not only that in school, Lord, but even as they travel about in the world, Lord, the teenagers and the ones who enter college, that you would protect them, Lord, and that you would just guide their thoughts and all that they do, Lord, that you would forgive them of any indiscretions and that you would always, Lord, be with them. I lift this all to you this morning, Lord, and trusting again that we know that you are a sovereign God and that you do all things well. So we honor you, we praise you, we bless you this morning, and again, we thank you for the privilege of just gathering in this place, Lord, that you have provided for us. And as with regards to our plans for the sanctuary, Lord, we just leave it all in your hands and we will wait on you, Lord. So let us be patient in waiting on you, Lord. We trust you, we love you, we honor you, we praise you, we give you glory and majesty and praise in the mighty name of Jesus our Savior and soon coming King. Amen.
Oh,
Matthew chapter 16, verses 5 to 12. Matthew 16, verses 5 to 12. Hear the word of the Lord. When they went across the lake, the disciples forgot to take bread. Be careful, Jesus said to them. Be on your guard against the yeast of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They discussed this among themselves and said, it's because we didn't bring any bread. Aware of their discussion, Jesus asked, you of little faith, why are you talking among yourselves about having no bread? Do you still not understand? Don't you remember the 5 loaves for the 5,000 and how many basketfuls you gathered? Mm-hmm. Or the 7 loaves for the 4,000 and how many basketfuls you gathered? How is it that you don't understand that I was not talking to you about bread? Mm-hmm. But be on your guard against the yeast of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Then they understood that he was not telling them to guard against the yeast used in bread, but against the teaching of the Pharisees and Sadducees.
Yes.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Consider this text and meditate with me on the thought. Focus. Focus. Let us pray. Lord God, now in this moment of proclamation, we invite you to open up this word to our understanding, and our hearts are ever grateful that you care enough to send us a word. And so, Lord, we lay ourselves open to you today, and we say, have your way. For we stand in your truth that says, when your word goes out, it does not return unto you void, but accomplishes the purpose for which it has been sent. Do a work in us today. Let me decrease now, Lord, so that you would increase, and the word come forth as you would have it.
Yes, Lord.
In the name of Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Today we find our heroes moving about, ultimately heading toward Caesarea Philippi, where they sometimes went for retreat. They went for times of refreshment there. And I remember this place from my Holy Land visit as a beautiful tropical kind of place in the desert, a quiet place with a waterfall and room to just be in nature. On their way to Caesarea Philippi, we see at the end of chapter 15 that they make an interim stop or pass through a place Matthew refers to as Magadan. This name is found nowhere else in scripture in the writings of antiquity, and it is suggested that it may be a reference to Magdala. The Hebrew translation of this word, Magadan, means harp in one form, and to cut, invade, or expose in another form. Some commentators think that Matthew may have been using Magadan intentionally as a pun, first as a nod to King David, who is a musician and who offered songs to God that held prophecy for the expected Messiah, but also as a reference to Jonah, who was ejected from the belly of the great fish on the shore in the vicinity of Magdala. When Jonah landed, he exclaimed, "Salvation is from the Lord." Mm-hmm. And of course, in the opening of this chapter, in his response to the request of the Pharisees for a sign, Jesus says, the only sign you will receive will be the sign of Jonah. Sadducees were constantly trying to trip Jesus up. They were always trying to catch him out, to get him to say something that would incriminate him or give them cause to have him arrested or make some complaint against him. We talk a lot about the Pharisees and the Sadducees, but do you remember who they were? They were both learned groups of people. The Pharisees claimed Moses and the law of Moses as the guide for all faith and living. They believed in the supernatural, like angels and demons and heaven and hell, but it was the law of Moses that determined how you would fare in the world and in eternity. They demanded that the people obey all the law, even though that was impossible for human beings. And the Pharisees loved to judge other people, never seeing their own faults. Jesus called them blind guides. The Sadducees were prosperous people. A lot of them were rich. And they were more associated with the temple and the priesthood. They made the sacrifices and maintain the temple order and purity. But it was all ritualistic for them. It was all about ritual. It didn't have to do with how you lived on a day-to-day basis or the true faith that comes from the heart. It was all about the outward show of religious practice. They did not embrace the supernatural. They had a greater love, or so it seems, for money. And they loved to lord their authority over others. So Jesus, who came reinterpreting the teachings of Moses and asserting the spirit over the law, while also upsetting the status quo in terms of ritual sacrifices and how sins are forgiven, embracing people who the temple gatekeepers may have shunned or kept out, this Jesus came and put both these groups on edge. Of course, we must be careful not to fall into what they do. We can't lump them all together. We know that there were some in these groups whose hearts were touched when they heard Jesus. But for the majority, in these two religious sects, as Jesus gained popularity, the Pharisees and Sadducees increasingly saw him as a threat and wanted him gone. We talk about them, but I just want you to remember who they are, because they are still intimidated and angered and feeling territorial today. After Jesus shut these seekers of a sign down, Jesus moves with his posse, and we don't know how much time has passed, but they had enough time, the scriptures say, to get in a boat and cross the Sea of Galilee. And I want to remind you, it's not an ocean like the Atlantic Ocean. The Sea of Galilee was also the Lake of Gennesaret. That was the other name for it. It is a lake. It is a vast lake, no doubt, but it's a lake. It's not an ocean. And it is possibly in this mid-crossing when Jesus utters the warning about the yeast of the Pharisees. Jesus always used examples and illustrations that people of his day could relate to. And so he makes this utterance. Of course, we don't hear all of the conversations that happened. We don't have all of the detail in a chronological order in terms of how they talked and, you know, the subjects that they discussed and things like this. We have pieces. We have clips. So we don't know what was happening. Did Jesus all of a sudden just come out and say, beware the yeast of the Pharisees and the Sadducees? You know, when they were talking about what happened last week in Mary's house. I don't know. But he says this, and for some reason the disciples don't immediately make the connection. He used these examples that people could relate to, but when he inserted them in conversation, they don't always catch on. If you've ever baked bread, or you're just familiar with baking, you know that yeast is used to make bread rise. The dough only requires how much? Just a smidgen of yeast, right? Just a smidgen of yeast, not much at all. And that is because yeast contains active microscopic cultures. Those live microorganisms spread quickly and easily through the whole dough. Jesus warned about the yeast because the infusion of dangerous ideas spreads profusely. Have you ever noticed how quickly bad news gets around? I said, if we told the gospel the way we share a gossip story, we'd be all right today. Bad news travels fast. Evil ideas and negative words seem to travel more quickly than good words do. And in these days of social media, the negative spreads much more quickly. People seem inclined towards the negative. I'm here, spill the tea. Spill the tea, I'm here for it.
Yep.
People always want to hear the negative. When Jesus utters about yeast, the disciples start talking about bread. He used the illustration, so if you understand how yeast works, you might make the connection. But he wasn't really talking about bread. But they're talking about bread in a very real sense. Oh my goodness, we got in this boat and we forgot to bring some bread. Jesus is using an example they can relate to, but they lose focus. So the Lord redirects their focus so they may see past the temporal into the spiritual. You of little faith, why are you talking among yourselves about having no bread? They had already forgotten the lesson of the loaves. You just saw me. You helped me. You helped me. Feed 4,000 plus people and 5,000 plus people with a few loaves and a few fish. Bread is not a problem for us, guys. You'll not starve. We can always get some bread. Focus. I am talking to you about the kingdom. I am trying to get you to see, not with your natural eye, but with your spiritual eye. Be on your guard. Focus. And I can imagine, I wonder if you can, sometimes Jesus trying to teach these disciples and I'm just thinking he would say, work with me, people. Just work with me. Focus. There were dangerous factions that had been misleading God's people and teaching people falsely about God and how people were to live. This had been happening. This is one of the reasons Messiah came. The people were going down the wrong path. They had the wrong understanding of who God is and how they are to live their lives before God. And Jesus came with a new revelation. He brought new understanding, clarified some things. You've heard it said, but I say, he gave people a new focus. Not on the letter of the law, but on the spirit of the law. Focus not on hate, focus on love. Focus not on revenge or retaliation, focus on forgiveness. Focus not on self-change, your focus to This is not unlike today. It is not what those who have always occupied the seats of power in our world want to hear. It's not what they want to hear. It's not what colonizers and settlers and those who think that indigenous peoples are beneath them want to hear. They are the Pharisees and Sadducees of our day, trying to make you stay in your place. When the former U.S. president came on the scene, he started his campaign with dangerous ideas, and most of us laughed and thought, he won't be around long. He won't go very far. People are going to see through this. And yet he was elected to the highest office in the land. It was unbelievable. It was impossible. It was ludicrous. How could this happen? How could the public allow such a thing to happen? And yet, it did. The dangerous yeast had spread throughout the entire country. And there were many who absorbed and spread this vicious, vile, and violent message. And even today, after almost a year of being out of office, his ideologies continue to rule in the hearts of many people who do not want to see those persons in society who have been marginalized receive any justice. They do not want to see equity. They do not want to address the wrongs that have been done. They do not even want to acknowledge that any wrong has been done. They rise up against simple things that can help all of society, all of the world, such as wearing a mask to protect against the pandemic. But they demand their rights as citizens while denying the rights of others. It is no doubt that many of these ideas, many of these wicked ideologies were asleep, lying dormant in the hearts of evil people all along, but they were awakened when the perfect storm of evil messaging met with power and authority in the office of the U.S. president. They produced evil fruit. And what had been sleeping was awakened with new strength because of a little yeast that had spread in the dough. Around the world, church, this yeast continues to spread. And now we see here in Nova Scotia perhaps some of the latest developments because of this yeast. The talks we have been having, the dawning of understanding in the minds of people since George Floyd's murder, the Black Lives Matter movement, the awareness that something needs to be done to address the issues of inequity and injustice in our society in regards to marginalized people, that those talks had begun to take root. But now, we see what looks like a spreading of the same poisonous yeast that seeks to thwart the efforts of those who are trying to do good, who are trying to make a change, who are trying to usher in a new era. Those who are trying to open doors. And now today it looks like we are going backward. But guess what? When the enemy comes to eat of your flesh, he will surely stumble and fall. I am so glad we serve a God who is keeping watch over us. We serve a God who watches over his word and is faithful to perform it. We
But we know what the outcome is.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
We know in the end we win. And we cannot let the things of this world take our eyes off of Jesus. Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. Focus. In a world that increasingly wants to turn to darkness, focus on the light that the Savior brings. It is by His light that our lives will shine. We are not defeated. We are not without hope. Our hope is in Jesus.
Hallelujah.
We are not defenseless. He got up with all power and authority in His hands. We have the entire witness, the assembly of the angels on our side, serving God's purposes in the world. And we are victorious no matter what it looks like to our natural eye, no matter what men may try to do to us. We put our trust in God and we focus. The word says no weapon formed against us shall prosper. God will prevail. Jesus said in this world you will have trouble, but be of good cheer. And we stand to meet the challenge.
Yes.
Having done all, we stand.
Yes.
And we believe God. We stand and we see the salvation of the Lord. We stand and we walk in the way that we know. We do not return evil for evil, but we return evil with good. Trust in the Lord and do good. God will continue to make a way for us. We're not in this by ourselves. The battle is not ours, it's the Lord's. Hallelujah. God will prevail, church. We just have to focus. Amen. If you're here this morning and you have not received the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, if you can't claim these promises of having God walk with you and be the power in your life, of making sure that His purposes are fulfilled in your life, if you can't say with certainty that if Jesus Christ returned this very second, that you would be going home with Him as He comes to claim His church, then as the choir sings, why don't you come? Come and give Him your life. Come and surrender to Him. Come and say you want to be a part of God's family.
Amen.
You receive the gift of salvation that He offers from Calvary's cross. That you want the life that He wants for you. An abundant life. So that no matter what happens in this world, you have joy. You have peace. You have the assurance of knowing God is on the throne.
Yes.
If you're here this morning and you haven't received Him, why don't you come?
Yeah.
the Spirit of God,
by the Spirit of God,
to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior,
to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior,
and on the profession of our faith,
and on the profession of our faith,
having been baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit,
having been baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit,
we do now in the presence of God,
we do now in the presence of God,
angels, and this assembly, most solemnly and joyfully, enter into covenant with one another, as one body in Christ.
As one body in Christ.
We engage therefore, by the aid of the Holy Spirit, to walk together in Christian love, to strive for the advancement of this church, in knowledge and holiness, to give it a place in our affections,
prayers and services,
above every organization
of human origin,
to sustain its worship,
ordinances,
discipline and doctrine,
to contribute cheerfully and regularly,
as God has prospered us,
towards its expenses,
for the support of a faithful,
an evangelical ministry,
among us,
the relief of the poor.
And the spread of the gospel
throughout the world.
In case of difference of opinion in the church,
we will strive
to avoid a contentious spirit.
And if we cannot
unanimously agree,
We will cheerfully recognize
the right of the majority
to govern.
We also engage
to maintain family and secret devotion,
to study diligently the Word of God,
to religiously educate our children,
to seek the salvation of our kindred
and acquaintances,
to walk circumspectly
in the world,
to be kind and just,
to those in our employ,
and faithful in the service,
we promise others.
Endeavoring in the purity of heart,
and goodwill towards all people,
to exemplify and commend
our holy faith.
We further engage
to watch over,
to pray for,
to exhort and stir up
each other,
unto every good word,
and work,
to guard each other's reputation,
not needlessly exposing,
the infirmities of others.
To participate in each other's joys,
and with tender sympathy,
bear one another's burdens,
and sorrows,
to cultivate Christian courtesy,
to be slow to give or take offense,
but always ready
for reconciliation,
being mindful of the rules
of the Savior
in the 18th chapter of Matthew. without delay.
To secure it without delay.
And through life.
And through life.
Amid evil report.
Amid evil report.
And good report.
And good report.
To seek to live.
To seek to live.
To the glory of God.
To the glory of God.
Who has called us out of darkness.
Who has called us out of darkness.
Into his marvelous light.
Into his marvelous light.
When we remove from this place.
When we remove from this place.
We engage as soon as possible.
We engage as soon as possible.
Unite with some other church.
To unite with some other church.
Where we can carry out the spirit of this covenant.
Where we can carry out the spirit of this covenant.
And the principles.
And the principles.
Of God's word.
Of God's word.
I wish to renew my covenant
renew
with God and all of his people. Instituted this ordinance so that we might remember the sacrifice that he made for us. His table is open to all who have confessed him as Lord and Savior and received baptism in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. He invites you to come to the table to commune with him and all of the saints who have gone on before. Come to the table not because you must, but because you may. Come not declaring your righteousness, but come declaring that you are in need of a Savior. Come, not because you've done everything well and good, but maybe you stumbled. Come desiring his strength. Come remembering his sacrifice. Come sharing in his love. Come because the Lord Jesus himself invites you to come. The word of God tells us that on the same night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, he blessed it, and then he broke it and said, "This is my body given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And in the same manner that he had taken the bread, he took the cup, and he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood, shed for the remission of sin and for the redemption of many." As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do proclaim my death until I come. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Deacon Thane will lead us in prayer for the Lord.
Our gracious and everlasting Lord, once again we come to this table. Even though we feel that we don't deserve to be at this table, thank God for your Son that allows us to come to this table one more time. We just think of the bread that is the body that was on that cross and the blood that was shed as well. We'll take and eat through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Together.
Lord and Savior, gather the disciples together to share their last meal, and after they have eaten, they share the Lord's Supper. Jesus took bread and he said, "Eat. This do in remembrance of me." Let us eat together. And in like manner, he took the cup and he said, "Drink from it, all of you. Let us drink." Giving in. You've managed the adjustments, changes, and the fluid.